us great pleasure to have Professor Rajiv Roshan here with us.
He's a faculty in the History Department of Punjab University. I won't list his academic credentials because they are quite vast and wide. He's on various advisory panels. He's done a lot of academic work papers, publications, and things like that. He likes writing in the press to reach out to a common audience also, not just to an academic audience. And he's been on the editorial board of textbooks, history textbooks. I wish I had those history textbooks when I was young, because the kind of history textbooks that we experienced when I was young was sort of quite unfortunate. We discovered him once when I was on a walk and I discovered a young man that I had seen before, and he turned out to be in my CS 101 class here. And so one of his sons is in the computer science department here, second year now, right? And I'd like to welcome Meeta Rajiv Roshan also, who is Secretary of the Urban Development
Finance now.
Department. Finance now. So you
move.
Okay. In Mantralaya, Maharashtra. So without much ado, I will let him introduce himself and his topic to us. The brief that we kind of gave him, that everybody is making this big hoo-ha about Make in India and things like that, it would be nice to hear from a historian their own perspective on Make in India, right? What did Make in India mean throughout the ages, and what does it mean to Make in India? Just because Modi government says we must make in India, right, it doesn't mean that tomorrow we'll start making everything in India. It needs much more than that. It needs an enabling infrastructure, it needs an enabling polity, it needs administration, bureaucracy, which can actually support all these activities. So if you go to Europe, for instance, you'll see how much of a role, a proactive role, the government is playing in kind of making innovations happen and bringing innovations to market. So Make in India is not just a question of saying that, hey guy, why don't we make in India? I'll give you tax breaks. That's not enough. We need to create that kind of resource which can make in India from ground up, from the kind of exposure they have at school, to college, upwards, and then to create a very enabling kind of environment. So what has been the context for making in India previously in the past, and what has changed over a period of time? So I thought that Professor Rajiv Roshan is a great guy to kind of give us a perspective on these things. Now, perhaps the guys at the back might want to come in front of you. These seats are free. You're not shy. Or come a little bit closer at least. I'll leave the floor to you, sir.
Namaskar. It's very nice of you to be here. Very kind of Kavi Arya to invite me once again to address this kind of a young gathering, young engineers. I look forward to talking to engineers partly because of all the academic disciplines that I interact with. Engineers are the only ones who actually seem to be doing something. Chahe wo padhai ke baare mein ho, chahe wo badmashiya karne ke baare mein ho. Jaise hamara university hai, it's got two engineering colleges associated, and we all live on the same small campus. And in that kind of a situation, we can see the difference between students who are taking up engineering, students who are taking up sciences, laws, medicine, and social sciences, humanities, cultural difference hota hai. So I look forward to having an interaction with engineers. This particular set of presentations, they're going to be a series of presentations. What I thought was, what I would do is this. I'll start off with a very general statement on rooting the Make in India project in Indian society and culture. After all, it's not possible for us to not root something here. Think about the tremendous development that we have had in the IT industry. All of a sudden, everything started growing and everything started happening very fast. And when people started looking for explanations, ki kyon ye aisa ho raha hai, to two explanations seem to be coming out. One was that this was an industry which was unregulated by the government. So if the government was not interfering with it, it would grow. But the second big thing was that this was a very Brahmanical industry. हाथ गंदे करने नहीं पड़ते थे. कुर्सी पे बैठ जाओ, दिमाग का इस्तेमाल करते रहो, observe करते रहो, and that was quite sufficient. Now, this kind of a thing, where people's responses are going to be rooted in their society, culture, the society and culture flows through you. So what I thought was ki we could start off by first talking about this general background, root the Make in India idea within the culture and society of India in the hope that we may be able to find some ways out. Now, surely, had we had answers ki hame aage kaise kadam badhane hai, kya karna hai, phir to koi sawal hi nahi tha. It is because this is an open-ended kind of a discussion, hence the importance of everyone joining in, everyone thinking about it, everyone making their suggestions, and it's when these million suggestions come in, we keep our fingers crossed and hope ki kuch na kuch something might click and something might change for the rest of us, make India a different country from what it already is. So it is with that background that I want to make this small presentation before you. It's a very small presentation today. There's not much information in it. So we'll keep it open-ended. Please stop me wherever you feel like stopping me. Ask questions wherever you want to ask questions. The various layers that go into the grand project of Make in India. The absolutely basic layer is the layer of the nation. How to make a nation. This was a project which has been going on for the last, at least in a documented form, for at least 100 years now. Is this project substantially complete? What happens to this project? What are the ups and downs in it? What are the kind of obstructions that come in? What are the kind of concerns that people express? How would you bring people together and ensure that no one feels left out, no one feels upset? Remember, our politicians, when they made those very corny statements, Indira Gandhi at one time made a statement, garibi hatao. Everyone knows garibi aise hatane se nahi hatti. But the phrase garibi hatao clicked so well that it worked for Indira Gandhi and the Congress party for the next 25 years. Modi came in, and Modi is someone whom you people have experienced. You've seen his election campaign. You've seen the manner in which the government has functioned. And Modi has been focusing on these corny statements. And quite a few of them seem to click. People respond positively to them. Just as there's a whole bunch of people who respond negatively to them. Chahe you respond positively, chahe you respond negatively, the basic thing is the audience has taken cognizance of what was being said, is in now actively interacting with that idea. So that is one basic idea, the idea of make a nation. Make a citizen. Making a nation is not sufficient. You need to have a citizen also. A citizen who thinks that the citizen has a connect with the nation. If there's no connection between the citizen and the nation will not function. If the citizen exists but the nation doesn't exist, then also this dyad will not function. So you need both. Saath hi saath, you need an economy. Making an economy. How does one go about creating an economy which enables the citizen and the nation to move forward? Make a society that is productive. Having an economy that is big. Bombay economy is massive. The Delhi economy is massive. But is it also productive? I really don't know. The Punjab economy is not massive. But is the Punjab economy productive? With due respect to the Urta Punjab people, Punjab kahi nahi ud raha, zameen pe khada hua hai. I am not a Punjabi, I come from Madhya Pradesh. I have been in Punjab 30 years. The one active, aggressive, constructive, meaningful state that I have seen in this country is Punjab. And now that I have been doing the history of 20th century Punjab very closely, I am discovering how they have moved forward. One step after the other, with all the jhagda fasad that is going on in Punjab, they seem to be moving forward. Hopefully that book is going to be finished by the end of this year on Punjab. But an article is coming out in September in the Economic and Political Weekly on governance in Punjab. All this is part of translating. Now, this is a specific statement concerning this particular presentation. Translating individual achievements into collective achievements. My proposition is this, that in India you have a large number of very good people with great achievements. individually, Indians end up doing quite a lot of great things. It is when you put the Indians together collectively that they seem to falter, that there seems to be some kind of a problem coming up. Skills we have always had. If you think that Make in India is about skilling India, sorry to say, we don't need skills. We already have the skills. Or if we don't have the skills, we know how to get those skills. And if we are not getting those skills, we are not getting those skills because we have decided that we don't want those skills. बिजली का तार लगाना है और उसमें हम कसम खाई थी एक दिन कि इंसुलेटर नहीं लगाएंगे तो मुझको लाख पढ़ाई करवा दो कि बिजली का तार जब जोड़ते हो तो ऊपर से एक इंसुलेटर लगाया करो क्योंकि मैंने वो एक अननोन कसम खाई थी आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू पुट एनी इंसुलेटर ऑन इट इफ इट रिजल्ट्स इन अ फायर इन अ 100 ईयर ओल्ड बिल्डिंग एंड 5000 पीपल लूज देयर लाइवलीहुड दैट्स परफेक्टली ऑल राइट बाय मी नाउ दैट इज द काइंड ऑफ थिंग व्हिच एग्जिस्ट्स इन इंडिया टुडे A man has the skills, knows how to obtain the skills, but the main thing is these skills per se are of very little value unless we somehow are able to root them in a knowledge society, unless we are somehow able to ensure that these skills generate meta-knowledge, knowledge out of which more knowledge is generated. Knowledge per se is not sufficient. Knowledge has to be leveraged to a point where it starts helping the society generate new knowledge for itself, and that is something on which we have been lacking till now. As we proceed in the course of these lectures, we will pick up small bits and pieces of all these things and carry them forward. Today we recall some very, very basic points about what Indians are and what Indians have done. As I said earlier, India is a country which is characterized by extremely superior individual achievement. This is a picture of a young man. He is Rajendra Bisht, Lieutenant Rajendra Bisht, who won the Sword of Honor at the IMA yesterday. He is featured in all the newspapers today. Yadi aap log akhbar padhte ho aajkal, to you would have seen this particular picture. This is General Dalbir Singh Suhag. He is the chief of the Indian Army. This is a chemical engineer, Raghunath Anant Mashelkar. Till very recently, he was the head of the biggest science organization in the country. He was the man who determined what science policy in India would be. This is Sukhdev Thorat. He's an economist. He still heads a number of very important bodies in the country, knowledge generation bodies, and he's a very powerful man in contemporary times. There's something very common about all these people. This young man, he's the son of the unit cook. He's the son of the unit cook. He's joined the IMA and he's demonstrated superior achievement in everything that you could possibly ask in an IMA candidate. No one in the IMA said, Chokra, tu cook ka beta hai, tu humse dur rahe. He's part of the team, he's part of the group, he's competed against the best that could come up. And he's demonstrated that he's superior to the best. And he's able to do that because the system in which he's living, that system is only asking for how good are you? These are the parameters on which your performance is going to be evaluated. Are you able to come up and top these parameters? And this young man has said, yes, I can. This fellow, he's the son of a JCO. Sipahi ka beta hai. He's ended up being the chief of the army staff. He's one of the top-notch commandos in India. The previous commando that we had top-notch was General V.K. Singh. He has demonstrated what Lieutenant Bisht might demonstrate in the next 25, 30 years, that high performance is not just about performing once, high performance is about performing again and again and again, and coming up with ideas which are going to determine the strategic thinking for this nation. Make in India is not something which the politicians have told us. Make in India is something which the military think tanks have told us. The military think tanks have told us, if you don't start making in India, if you don't start creating something unique in India, something strong in India, the nation is going to be weak. So when a hyper-nationalist government comes in, the hyper-nationalist government picks it up and says, okay, here we go full blast on this project. This is not the first time that militaries have responded like this to people. The American army, the American military had made a statement, a formal policy statement in the 1950s, which is one of the most important policy statements in the realm of education, in which they said, the defense of America lies in its universities. If the Russians have been able to send the Sputnik up, the only way that Americans can match the Russians is by strengthening their universities and strengthening their skills. So this kind of lateral thinking coming from the army types, this please remember, this is fairly common across the world. In India, it came as a consequence of these men, V.K. Singh, Dalbir Singh Sohag, iske pehle bhi ek JCO ka beta tha, General V.P. Malik, sare ke sare sipahiyon ke bete hain jo ki aapke desh ko lead kar rahe aur aapke desh ki security ko handle kar rahe hain. Raghunath Anant Mashelkar, chemical engineering from the Bombay Chemical Engineering Department, iski maa baroni thi, ghar pe bartan nahi manjte, bhai aati hai. That's what she did. Didn't stop the young man from going out becoming one of the top-notch scientists of India. Didn't stop him from becoming one of the top-notch science administrators in India. Ek do saal rahe hote to samajh mein aata. 11 saal rahe. Consistently demonstrating that it's possible for him to head an organization and take Indian science forward. Sukhdev Thorat, son of a cobbler. Haath se kaam karte the. And these are stories of success, not today. Today, though, we hear a lot of stories of success coming up, ki falane falane rikshe wale ka beta IAS ban gaya, falane rikshe wale ka beta, ya falane khomche wale ka beta IIT mein aa gaya. We keep on hearing these stories. These are stories coming up to us from the 1950s and the 1960s. At a time when India was still supposed to be considerably dakyanusi, considerably conservative, and not a very liberated society. The small thing is this. In India, it's not just people who come from socially well-off backgrounds who have been able to do well. In India, anyone and everyone has been able to do well. Go back and have a look at your industrialists and businessmen and people who are extraordinarily rich. And you will discover that the number of people who are extraordinarily rich, whose father was also rich, you can actually count them on the hands of one finger. These are people, most people who are millionaires and billionaires in India are people who have become millionaires and billionaires out of their own effort. In the recent past, don't get too carried away by the political rhetoric of crony capitalism and corruption and stuff like that. That is part of the game. You use any skill, any trick that is available for you to move forward. So why should you create a society in which you need these negative skills? How to bribe a tehsildar? Hey, ye bhi koi skill hai seekhne ka. How to bribe a sarkari officer? Hey, nahi, sorry, ye, why have you created a system in which you need to learn this kind of a skill? So despite all the negativities and all the obstructions that have been in our country, these are people who have done rather well for themselves. Here is just a stray piece of information for you about the amount of gold that India has. These are figures coming from the World Gold Council, which is the apex body of gold, handling gold in the world. They keep track of all such information. America has 8,133 tons of gold, official gold holding. India has 557 tons of official gold holdings. In 2014, the demand for gold from India was the 1/4 of the demand that comes from the rest of the world. Gareeb desh ki hum baat kar rahe, third world country ki hum baat kar rahe. 1/4 of the total world demand is coming from India for this precious metal. 842 tons. The total holdings of gold in private hands in India, which was calculated in 2009, 15,000 tons. This is definitely not a country which is poor. People may be poor, individuals may be poor, but the country has no shortage of money. And if you think that the country has no shortage of money, kya ye dusre jagah pe nazar aata hai? Look at all this tremendous startup funding that is happening. This funding would not happen unless there was someone with surplus money. You come up, you say that I've got an idea, and someone says, okay, I've got the money for it. They're sitting on pots of money. And if your country does not provide for an opportunity to invest, they're going to take the money to Brazil, they're going to take the money to Ireland, they're going to take it to France, they're going to take it to England, they're going to take it to America, they're going to take it to Korea, which is what all your big companies have done. India has no shortage of individual skills. India has no shortage of capital. What India does have is a tremendous shortage of ability to use knowledge. Hanuman ji kya hai? Recent Hanuman ji ka image. Hanuman ji has been asked to get Sanjeevani booty. Hanuman ji pure aims ko utha laate hai. This is, the cartoonist is making fun of both Hanuman ji and saying something positive about AIIMS. But the thing is this, ki such organizations like AIIMS, in the end, the country has been able to produce only one. Thoda sa jyada liberal ho jao to maybe two. Thoda sa aur jyada liberal ho jao to maybe three. Now, this is bad. It can't be one, two, or three. There have to be at least 20 AIIMS-like organizations in India. Not colleges which are called AIIMS, which is what the previous government did, but colleges which actually perform like AIIMS, where you can send Hanumanji and say ki jo bhi bimari hai, mare hue aadmi ko bhi ye jinda kar sakte hain. When I look back at all this, to me what occurs is that there was a key turning point in the history of our nation. That key turning point in the history of our nation seems to have impacted our thinking, the responses of this country, the responses of this state in various ways. And that perhaps was the partition of the country. The partition of the country that happened, that essentially disrupted the social ecosystem. It was not colonialism which did the disruption. It was not the Angrej which did it. It was the partition which did it. As we shall see in greater detail later, we'll talk about the Angrej period and see what did the Angrej people do. They created a lot of obstructions before us. But they were obstructions. There's a difference between having an obstruction and simply being like having your neck ringed. In 1947, it was jaise kumbhi ka sir uda diya ho, is tarah ka Hindustan ke samaj ke saath kiya gaya tha. And that seems to keep on hurting the society in a wide variety of ways. Around the same time that India was looking for independence and going to become independence in a very ghastly fashion, Jawaharlal Nehru was putting his mind to the idea about what is India? How can you make Indians work together? How can you have Indians together? And Jawaharlal Nehru came up with this grand idea, which became one of the staples of all standard knowledge about India, the grand idea of unity in diversity. He writes about unity in diversity in the Discovery of India. It's just a phrase. There's nothing more to it. But it's a phrase which captures the imagination of everyone because they can immediately see that this is precisely what India is. Everyone is different. Everyone comes from a different social background, different cultural background, different way of behavior, different way of thinking. And yet there is some kind of unity. What this unity is, no one seems to know. Nehru wanted to emphasize unity since the British had been emphasizing disunity among Indians in a big way. The British were emphasizing the disunity of Indians to the extent of saying that there did not exist an Indian nation. So if India did not exist as a nation, then there was no point in having a national movement, there was no point in asking for freedom, there was no point in asking for independence. What's the point of having existed in the first place? That was the baseline for the modern world to be a nation, to be a nation which started from the borders of Afghanistan, Peshawar, Rawalpindi, went down to Kanyakumari, on this border from Burma, coming down to Kutch, Karachi. This was the big nation that everyone was looking for. There were some people who still suspected that we are not yet fully formed. Within the Congress, there would be people, within the national movement, there were people who kept on saying, India is a nation in the making. We need to work forward and make India into a nation. India is not a nation. India is separate entities. They need to be put together. The nation needs to be formed. And then, of course, the question is, how do you form a nation? No one knows how to form a nation. No one has ever created a nation. So, mamla wo golmol sa hoke reh jata tha. Kareeb 30-40 saal to main bhi isme bada vishwas karta raha, unity and diversity mein. Phir, as a professional historian, I started looking at it in a professional way. And I said, okay, this big question about unity and diversity of India. Now, let me check out which are the countries of the world which are not diverse. Let's ask a different question. Let's not ask about which countries are united. Let's ask, what are the diversities in countries? And suddenly it occurred to me ki there's a diversity in every village in the world. Wherever you have three people, there is diversity. Two people, you can say this is a couple, but the moment you add a third fellow, it's diverse. And this diversity goes to the extent that the Canadians have been voting every 10 years or so, should Canada remain united? But the Canadians don't say this is threatening to Canada. All that they say is that if the Francophones want to go out, that's perfectly all right. The Spanish have a problem of terrorism because there's a bunch of people who say, we want a separate nation for ourselves, hame chahiye azadi. The French have a province which says, we want independence from France. The Germans have a province which says, we want independence. The Turks have three provinces which want independence. The Russians, the USSR broke up in front of our eyes. So we know that that unity which the USSR demonstrated to the world did not exist. The Americans seem to be united, especially united in their hatred for communism, hatred for the USSR, hatred for the rest of the world, desire to make money. Jitna rokda aa jaye haath mein utna badhiya rahega hamare liye. Singular minded behavior of the Americans. So then I looked at the Americans a bit close and it turned out, no. The Americans had even more problems than we ever had in India. The Civil War, about which we have heard, the Civil War happened because there came a president who did not have much of an experience of being a politician. He was a naive fellow. Like when you go into American history, you discover that Abraham Lincoln, when he contests for presidentship, he's completely naive. He knows very little about politics. It is because he knows very little about politics that he makes those weird statements. Slaves liberate hone chahiye. Arre ye bhi koi baat tha, slaves liberate kara. You can't ask for a division of America. America mein janmjat adhikar hai. Everyone has the right to break away from America. Every 15 years in America, there would be some state which would, the state legislature would pass a resolution saying, we break away from America. We don't want to be part of the USA anymore. And that was just about all right. I mean, theek hai, you want to break away? Fair enough. No one has heard you out too much. In 1812, the British attacked America. America has been independent since 1776. So 1812, quite a lot of time has elapsed. The British attack America, and of all the states of America, six say, that is close to half the states of America, they say, we support the British. We don't want the United States anymore. We want to go back to the British. That is the episode in which the British forces come down, occupy Washington, burn the White House. This new White House that we see was constructed after the war with Britain. The reason why those six states did not break away actually had nothing to do with politics. Imagine here is the Congress sitting in Washington, planning to attack the British in the north. Canada has not been formed yet. These six states have a separate meeting in New York. They pass a resolution saying that we will supply arms and ammunition to the British, we will supply men to the British, we will support the British in this war, we will attack the Americans, and then they pass this resolution, they give it to a ghursawar and ask the ghursawar to go to Washington or dekhe aao jo meeting chal rahi hai usme. Beech mein ghoda mar jata hai. Wo ghode ko jyada speed se daudaya, ghode ki tabiyat kharab ho gayi, ghoda mar gaya. So he had to wait for a second horse. That took some time. In the meanwhile, the American Congress has met and already declared war on against the British, and the war takes place. So once the war has started, these six guys say, fair enough, now hum ek kone mein baithe rahenge, we won't participate in the war. In America, the division between people is to that extent. And then when Abraham Lincoln wins America, becomes the president, the same set of states, but now six more have been added to it. 13 states say, we don't want this person as president. You must have come across these phrases, Modi tumhara prime minister hai. Manmohan Singh mera prime minister hai. Oh, sorry, prime minister ek bar chun liya gaya to tumhara bhi hai, mera bhi hai. But people in positions of responsibility have been publicly known to make these statements. Your prime minister, your president. When Abraham Lincoln is elected as the president, these 13 states say they don't accept Abraham Lincoln as the president because he supports abolition of slavery. And on that point, they sit down and this time they pass a much more serious resolution to break away from America. Abraham Lincoln says, remember I told you he doesn't have much experience of politics. He says, how can you pass such a resolution? You pass such a resolution, I'll send my army against you. The American army goes against South Carolina. The Civil War starts. And as the Civil War proceeds, the American Congress passes a law which says, no state has the right to secede from the United States. The law debarring people from breaking away is passed as late as that. नेहरू जी की जब बात मेरे को इतनी अच्छी लगी तो मेरे को थोड़ा सा ये लगा नेहरू जी हमारे साथ ना धक्का कर गए. He should have told us all this background about diversity. Countries, societies, people have routinely and regularly lived with diversity. Once in a while, in fact only once in the case of the US, did they say ki this diversity is going to result in a war between us. But most of the time they have simply said, fair enough, everyone will live together, there's no problem. India is the only country in which we go on making such a hoo-ha about we have what unity in diversity. What unity in diversity? We presume we have to have unity. We presume that we have to have diversity. So why are we so upset about this whole idea and why do we keep on wo jaise thoda mental problem ho gaya ho desh ko. Constantly insisting ki we are united. Arey Baba, you are united. Why are you insisting that you are united? You are part of a single whole. The rest of the world thinks that you are a single whole. You are the only one who keeps on saying you are different. And much of the reason for that is the British, the manner in which they interpreted India for us. This is a small table showing how the British wanted India to sit down, and when India was making a constitution for herself, in this constitution, the principle was that every voice within the country should be heard. So how did they define voice? Who should be the every voice? Christians, they should have separate representation. Dalits, doctors, government officers, Hindus, industrialists, Jains, lawyers, Parsis, teachers, traders, tribals. Sikho ke isme representation nahi mila because the Sikhs said we don't want to participate in this kind of a nonsense exercise in which everyone is being identified by their caste, class, culture, profession, etc., etc. We presume, this is the Akali Dal making a statement, Master Tara Singh. We presume the Sikhs say that we are part of India, everyone is part of India, and you do not need to sit down and make Indians divide up Indians in this particular fashion. When Master Tara Singh makes this statement, every other Sikh leader, whether they be in the Communist Party, whether they be in the Congress Party, they also support the Akali Dal. And they say, yes, this is a sensible thing to do. you cannot have divisions like this within the country. However, later on by April, the Sikhs also fall in line and they participate. Baba Saheb Ambedkar, who has not been able to participate for a variety of reasons, Baba Saheb Ambedkar is specially brought into the Constituent Assembly, and thus the Constituent Assembly of India is constituted, in which each and every body of people is being represented. The thing is to notice this, the various ways, the various strategies being used to divide the people of India. This was one of the legacies which the British left us, and we took it extremely seriously. Caste, creed, profession ke saath saath jo sabse bada division India mein logon ne identify kiya, that was about language. The British identified something like 3,000 languages for India. The census of India currently identifies something like 300 languages for India. This is that list of 300. Many of these languages, you may not even have heard about them. There's a language called Kannada. There's one language called Konicha, Kherwari, Khiragan. Small bits of people talking these languages. One day someone sat down and did an analysis of the British census reports. Indians speak 3,000 operational languages. So how many speakers to these languages? Turned out that there was a handful of languages which were spoken by one person. Like, minute. If you have a language which is being spoken by one person, is this even a language? Or what kind of criteria to use it to define it as a language? There's a whole lot of languages which were spoken by less than 20 people. Now, less than 20 people means this is a bunch of people which is less than an extended family. And yet, it was presumed that each of these languages should be given equal representation in the various decision-making processes that the country is going to have. When there is something, someone who is in an overwhelming position of power vis-a-vis you, people have a tendency, people across the world have a tendency to accept those norms, ideas, whatever is being done. In the case of India, it was not just the British and the colonial, it was also the language of the British and the colonial which we adopted. And soon after we became independent, we started saying that we don't want to follow this language. English should be removed. Intense debates took place in the Constituent Assembly. Equally intense debates took place in the Rajya Sabha and the Lok Sabha on we should not use the English language. And yet, time after time, it turned out that the English language was the only one which we could actually use across the country without raising hackles. We can speak Hindi, people will understand across the country most of the time. We can speak Marathi and most people will understand across the country most of the time. We can speak Punjabi and most people will understand the language most of the time. And the only problem is ki all that will also raise a tremendous amount of hackles everywhere. Only language which will not raise hackles till today is the English language. So why this happens, that's a different story altogether. The thing is, we had at some point which seemed that we had accepted and adopted, we had internalized the definition about ourselves which the Angrej had provided us. We had presumed that that is what we were. Were we really that? That is an open question and we shall talk about it later. Now, all the Angrej people were not saying bad things about India. There were some guys who were saying good things also. This is a statement which Mark Twain makes. Mark Twain has come on a visit to India. He's toured India extensively and he says, "So far as I am able to judge, nothing has been left undone either by man or nature to make India the most extraordinary country that the sun visits on his rounds. Nothing seems to have been forgotten. Nothing overlooked." This is a statement which comes in 1899. This is a statement which is published in the newspapers, is written about in books. So this is not a private statement. This is a very public statement. So ye statements bhi hamare samne hai. Humne in statements ko to ignore kar diya. Wo jo dusre negative statements the, unko pure samaj ne mano. The whole society had decided that they will accept only that. Khair, khuda na kaasta, ek din we became independent. And as we became independent, everyone else decided that we also want to become independent. The independence movements within the country took a while to grow, to mature, to become articulate. But once they did become articulate, one of the first independence movements that the country faced was that of Nagalim. Formation of an independent Nagaland. Formation of an independent Nagaland also resulted in a war which went on for almost 3 decades. A proper war in which 3 divisions of the Indian Army were being used, the Naga people were being targeted, some fairly, some unfairly. We don't know what was happening in this war. But as a result of this war, the government of India came up with a new set of laws, which is known as the AFSPA, which said that the Indian Army has the right to shoot Indian civilians. Nowhere in the civilized world is the National Army allowed to shoot its own citizens. When the American Army shot one of the terrorist supporters in Syria, cases were lodged against the American Army in America, saying, how did you shoot an American? The government said, but the guy was a terrorist. They said, no. He was a terrorist means he should be tried in the law courts. You guys don't have the right to kill him. In India, in contrast, we had people demanding independence right in the beginning. While the Nagas were busy demanding independence for themselves, came the Assamese who wanted independence for themselves. Separate flag, separate passport, separate currency, separate taxation system. They set it up all. These are the criteria for being a sovereign nation. The Nagas, the Assamese, they set up sovereign nations for themselves, or at least they claimed it and they followed all the basic rules of being a sovereign nation. At some point, the Sikhs decided, Asi Swatantra, they became independent. The Khalistan movement came up and the Khalistan movement spread rapidly and influenced the rest of the country. The Nagas and the Assamese were not influencing everyone. The Khalistan movement was influencing the entire country. And yet, each of them, one after the other, remember we are talking about a country which does not have a very strong army for suppression. And you forget the killer instincts of the army and the greatness of the Indian Army. The Indian Army simply does not have the wherewithal to suppress people. Despite having a police force which is reasonably ineffective, despite having an administration which does not do much administration, despite having a state which does not have adequate coercive power, यदि आप independence movement चलाना चाहते हो, सरकार के खिलाफ लड़ाई लड़ना चाहते हो, सरकार के पास उतनी क्षमता नहीं है कि वो आपको दबा सके आसानी से. And yet, each one of them, one after the other, came back and joined the mainstream. Today there are at least 4 MLAs in Punjab who are part of the active part of the Khalistan movement. Nagaland, there was a time when the entire government of Nagaland, the proper formal government of Nagaland, was made up of former militants, people who had been participating in pitched battles against the Indian Army. The same goes for Assam. The present government of Assam, the one which was defeated in the polls just a few weeks ago, each and every one of them had been part of this freedom struggle that the Assamese had. There was something going on which pushed people. On the one side, they all said, yes, we want independence, we want to move away. But at the same time, there was something happening which pushed them back into the mainstream of the country. In the case of Nagaland, at least we have concrete evidence. The Naga rebel leaders, after it became too hot for them in India, after the Chinese stopped helping them as much as they wanted to be helped, the Naga leaders escaped to London and made London their base. In the 1980s, early 1990s, the discussions between the Naga leaders and the government of India started, ki bahut ladai ho gayi, now everyone should go back to normal and stop fighting with each other. In the course of those discussions, they gave out some public interviews. So those public interviews are available to us from the press. In one of the interviews, the Naga leaders are asked by this journalist, look here, you people wanted an independent Nagaland. The Indian army was not too strong. It did not control you too much. You were in a terrain where it was possible for you to fight an effective guerrilla war against the army and throw it out. And then in 1962, the Chinese attacked Assam. The government of India shifted from Assam to Calcutta. Assam had effectively gone into the hands of the Chinese. The entire Northeast was in the hands of the Chinese effectively. This was your golden chance to declare independence. You already were Chinese allies. You already were fighting a war with the help of Chinese weapons. You already had money coming from China. China had driven the government of India out of your territory. There was no Indian government 700 miles around you. So why did you not declare yourself to be independent? Rational, reasonable question to be asked of a rebel leader. And the rebel leader's answer was marvelous. He said, "We did meet and discuss the issue of declaring independence. And then we decided we'll remain within India and keep on opposing the government of India rather than declare ourselves independent." The same statement was made by the people of Khalistan. ठीक है कैलिफोर्निया के बंदों को छोड़ दो जो कैलिफोर्निया चला गया और कनाडा में चला गया वी आर नॉट कंसर्न्ड विद दोज गाइस एनीमोर बट देयर इज अ होल बंच ऑफ खालिस्तानीज लिविंग इन पंजाब दे आल्सो से द सेम थिंग वी विल रिमेन इन इंडिया वी विल फाइट फॉर आवर राइट्स एंड एटलीस्ट फॉर 7 years नाउ आई एम होपिंग द सेम वुड हैपन विद द पीपल ऑफ कश्मीर. Not once have they said that they want independence from India. Once in a while they make naras about Pakistan, but they remain and create trouble for India within India. देखो अपने घर में जब लड़ाइयां होती है ना तो ऐसे ही होता है. घर छोड़ने की बात नहीं होती है, बात यह होती है कि हम तुम्हारे सिर पे कूदते रहेंगे तब तक जब तक कि तुम मेरी बात ना सुनना शुरू कर दो. प्रॉब्लम यह है, ये मेरी बात है क्या? What is it that you really want? These are big movements. They vanished about 20 years ago. We haven't had a big political movement in 20 years. Your generation came up at a time when India had become peaceful and India had become prosperous. So you haven't experienced any of this. And yet, when Kanhaiya came up in JNU and said, "Hame chahiye azadi," across the campuses of India, people got up and said, "Bahut badhiya bol raha hai, kitna acha bola isne." The question was, "Kis cheez ki azadi chahiye?" So he sat down and he explained, "Casteism se azadi chahiye, regionalism se azadi chahiye." I mean, then he made all those nice statements which a good Indian citizen is supposed to be making. The point is this, that the phrase azadi, just like the phrase garibi hatao that Indira Gandhi gave, just like those numerous catchphrases that Narendra Modi is dishing out to us, they catch people's fancy. So did the phrase "Hame chahiye azadi" that Kanhaiya said. It caught our fancy, and we decided that this was a very nice thing to happen. Now, surely, as a sentient being, it is important for us to understand why is this being said, what is being said, because remember, you are not part of the hoi polloi. यदि आप अपनी स्टैटिस्टिकल एनालिसिस करो कि हु यू आर इन दिस कंट्री, वेयर डू यू स्टैंड इन दिस कंट्री, यू विल डिस्कवर दैट यू आर इन दैट टॉप, सो सच अ स्मॉल स्लाइवर ऑफ एग्जिस्टेंस दैट यू गाइस कैन ओनली बी डीम्ड टू बी द सीरियस इलीट्स ऑफ दिस सोसाइटी. यू आर सम ऑफ द बेस्ट दैट इंडिया हैज प्रोड्यूस्ड. यू कैन नॉट बी पार्ट ऑफ दैट ग्रुप विच गोज इन अ धरना एंड सेज आजादी आजादी और हाय हाय जिंदाबाद. Remember, in any political movement, the people who say Zindabad Murdabad and the people who explain ki kis cheez ke liye Zindabad Murdabad karna hai. So when you are participating in public activities, you are the set of people who are thinkers, who are thinking, who you cannot be cannon fodder. Let's put it this way. The social elite has never been cannon fodder ever. The Azadi thing in India, however, is a very, very serious matter. I may not know what Kanhaiya is saying when he says azadi chahiye. You may not know what he means azadi chahiye. But in India, someone or the other has been saying Azadi chahiye for a very long time. One day I sat down and I made this table and I'm sharing this particular table with you. India was born out of an intense national movement. About that there is no doubt. Maybe that is what provided us the base paradigm for demanding independence and freedom for all of us. Once that was decided that there's a national movement and it's important, after that, everyone had their own definition of what a national movement would be, what independence would be, what freedom would be, what broad movements would be, and this is a broad list. You guys have done your history in your up till class 10th. You're familiar with this bit of history at least. 1905, Swadeshi movement chalu hota hai. Some historians say, people say, 1905 se national movement shuru hota hai. So if you count it from 1905, the 1905 to 1947, 42 years chala national movement. Some guys say that the national movement started in 1857 with the mutiny of 1857. So if you count it, the 1857 as your baseline, then the national movement lasted 90 years. Some people say that the national movement started with the conquest of Nagpur, when the Bhosle of Nagpur lost the war in 1818. This is the time which is known as the Third Maratha War, the establishment of English paramountcy in India and the establishment of basic opposition to the British in India. So that is 1818. Some people say that asal mein toh hamari azadi chhini thi jab musalman yahan pe aa gaye the. Toh yadi musalmanon ke aane se Hindustan ki azadi chhin gayi thi, you count that. That puts the dasta and the struggle for freedom to 1100, and from 1100 to 1947, it lasted 847 years. If you talk about caste, that caste is the big oppressive thing and it's independence from caste that we want. In that case, the dominance of Brahmanwad, for the last 20 years at least, the idea that this nation is oppressed by the Brahmins has been doing the rounds. So if you think about oppression of Brahmanwad, then it comes to at least 2,396 years, approximately the time when Gautam Buddha comes into existence and becomes popular. That's when the first opposition to Brahmanwad comes in, na? And of course, there is Faiz Ahmad Faiz and other radical people who say that Azadi to abhi bhi nahi mili. Hum to abhi bhi bahut hi dabe hue log hain. Hamari dum abhi bhi dabi hui hai. Koi is soti hui dum ko utha de. This is how Faiz Ahmad Faiz writes in his poetry. The radical people think very well of all such ideas. So, hum abhi bhi azad nahi hue hain. Whatever the basic thing is, hamare yahan azadi is a big thing. Independence from something or the other is a very big thing. We may not know what is it that we want, but we definitely know ki we are stuck in a hole and we really don't want to remain in this hole for too long. In the last 20 years, all this negativity about being suppressed, oppressed, not being able to do enough, all this negativity got translated somehow into great creativity. The two areas where we saw a lot of creativity and individual, not just individual creativity, but also collective creativity was the medical industry and the IT industry. Both seemed to have grown dramatically all of a sudden. And both seemed to be producing results which were the best in the world. In the medical industry, they generated world-class medical facilities at one-tenth the rate. And they're still very competitive. In the IT industry, they involved thousands of people, invested millions of rupees, and were able to generate a tremendous amount of creativity, wealth, value for society, and this happened to such an extent that people who joined both these industries, the medical industry and the IT industry, they turned back and told the rest of the society, you people don't know how to work. Because the rest of the society was standing wherever it was, or ye jo do hisse the industry ke ye aage nikal gaye sabse. They turned back and they said, you don't know how to work, to the extent that in the IT industry, when the communists went and said, let's have a workers' movement, let's have a labor union, the people said, no, we don't want a labor union. It was not the owners of capital who said that we won't allow you a union. It was the workers who said, we don't want a union. Abhi hal mein thoda sa, Madras mein thoda sa farak ho gaya hai, because the HCL, they fired a man and he went to court and the court has said that the HCL people can have a union of their own, but I don't know what will come out of that kind of a thing. The thing was this, ki at least on two occasions in the last 20 years, we have demonstrated that it's possible for us to go forward and do something new. But while we are doing this something new, while we are trying to bring all that diversity together, while we are trying to bring all those different kinds of people in one place, is it possible for this country to become greater than what those individual people are? Individually, we are great. In terms of capital, we have no shortage in the society. If you think that the banks don't have capital, look at Baba Ramdev, he has capital. Look, Baba Ramdev is a scamster, some people say. Okay, okay. So then look at Baba Ramvriksh Yadav. Heard about Ramvriksh Yadav? No. Baba Ramvriksh Yadav recently was shot dead by the police, or maybe he killed himself in a blast. This was the Mathura episode in which 3,000 and odd people occupied this place. He was a break off Baba from a big Baba movement. And the administration says that he has something like 1400 crore rupees worth of wealth. Baba Ramvriksh Yadav, close to being illiterate. His followers are all villagers of UP and Bihar and Madhya Pradesh. Gareeb kisan uske followers hain. And he has been able to garner that much wealth. Baba Ramvriksh Yadav broke away from a larger movement called the Jai Gurudev movement. You must have seen the posters of the Jai Gurudev movement if you travel by train. When you travel by train, when you reach some of the stations, the diwaron pe likha hota hai Jai Gurudev, Jai Baba Gurudev, Gaye ki hatya mat karo, is tarah ke statements. They've been written for the last 30-40 years now. The government estimates that he has got wealth worth 14,000 crore rupees. He's the leader of poor kisans of India. The more organized people, the Baba of Bias, the Baba of Sirsa. If you haven't seen the films made by the Baba of Sirsa or not heard his songs, I strongly recommend that you please go to YouTube and watch both the songs and the film. They are hits. Yaar, haso mat. Janta ko achha laga, bole to achha tha. Our point for today is simply this. कैपिटल की इस समाज में कोई कमी नहीं है, क्योंकि यदि कैपिटल की कमी होती तो इस बाबा के पास भी नहीं होता. अकल की भी कोई कमी नहीं है. प्रॉब्लम ये है, हाउ टू गेट द अकल आउट, हाउ टू गेट द कैपिटल आउट, एंड हाउ टू पुट देम टुगेदर क्लोज टू ईच अदर इन अ फैशन दैट इट ट्रांसफॉर्म्स दिस सोसाइटी. वी आर इन अ होल अबाउट दैट, देयर इज नो डाउट. टेक्स अस आउट ऑफ दिस होल and puts us at a point where we can start clapping about India being really great rather than clapping about India's greatness simply because we think that we should be nationalists and therefore we are clapping. So for the moment, this is about all that I would like to share with you. If you have any responses, batao. Why only the medical industry and the IT industry? That is your question. Why is it that this quest for independence, quest for doing something, results in the sudden spurt of the IT industry and the medical industry? Two possible answers. Remember, to these questions, which are still questions in the making, it's not possible to give a firm answer. So just open thoughts that I'm sharing. It's possible that the medical industry grows up because traditionally India has been very strong in the medical field. Traditionally bole to pre-19th century, pre-modern times say. We'll talk about this in greater detail in one of the later lectures, how the medical industry is actually very powerful in India. When the Prime Minister made that statement about Ganesh ji ka sir kalam karke laga diya tha and it was a sign of plastic surgery, etc., and the rest of the country laughed and said, ha ha ha, what a joke, this guy doesn't know his history and his science. Excuse me? The guys who were laughing, they were wrong. Plastic surgery of the nose and the ear has been going on in India at least for 2,000 years now, documented 2,000 years. We have the instruments that were in use, we have the procedures that were in use, we have all that written down. Whatever medical industry India had traditionally before the Muslims came, once the Muslims came in, it got strengthened with yet another stream of knowledge. That was the Yunani. This remained very strong and powerful right up till the 19th, early 20th century. Late 19th, early 20th century, these traditional bits of knowledge for India, they simply faltered completely and lost all legitimacy because they could not deal with one special disease which came up. This disease was called plague. Why the disease spread and why the knowledge could not cope with this disease is something which is to do with the history of medicine of those times. The second disease which came up was cholera. We didn't know how to handle cholera. Later on, in the 1990s, when a bunch of scholars went in to study the history of medicine in India and Egypt, they discovered that plague and cholera are not diseases that you should be curing. Plague and cholera are diseases that you should prevent. India was very good at preventing both plague and cholera. So we didn't have a plague of plague and a plague of cholera in India through history. And it happened all of a sudden in the 19th century because of some dramatic changes that had happened in society at that time. The manner in which people lived, the manner in which people were being bunched together, etc. The point is this, when in the 1970s, 80s, 90s, the modernization became firm, and in the 1990s, all of a sudden it became possible for Indian medical industry to expand and reach out to patients from abroad, the basic knowledge, the basic systems were already in place. And therefore, it was easy for something to be leveraged up and create this new reality in which we can say that the medical industry is a very successful industry. The IT industry, my suspicion is, I've off and on shared it with professors of computer science, they seem to concur with it, at least tentatively, is ki India is also a very Brahmanical country. Haath se log nahi kaam karna chahte. Anything which is going to dirty my hands, make me do something physical, Indians don't like that. The IT industry is a very Brahmanical industry in that sense, that you really have to just sit back and you produce results. That's a tentative kind of a thing. But some people also say that the IT industry grew because there was a boost that it got. Indian engineering colleges are seriously bad. I mean, with due respect to everyone around here, jab duniya ka categorization ke dekhte ho, duniya se compare karte ho, these colleges are very bad colleges. Yahan ka jo knowledge hai, bahut purana knowledge hai. And then all of a sudden, the world somehow got scared ki Y2K mein humare computers ka kya hoga. Everyone else had upgraded their knowledge and become very proficient in C++ and C++ and God knows what. Indians were knowledgeable in Fortran and whatever those primitive languages of those times were. The only technicians who were available to deal with your Y2K problem were Indians. They were available in great quantities and they could come together and work hard at it. So you had a transformation happening. And of course, once they got together and started doing things, then they became some of the best in the world very quickly. So that would be the tentative answer to why these two industries. In fact, that would work out both for the medical industry also. These are the question is, the comment is that the IT industry requires less investment, less capital. That's extremely possible, that this is an industry where you can do produce great results without the input of too much capital. Yadi aapne thekedari karni hai, bahut capital lagta hai. Aapne dam banana hai, bahut capital lagega, but not for the IT industry, not for a hospital.
A productive economy is an economy which allows everyone to be doing things that they feel like doing. This is Marx's old statement from the 19th century. You want to become a great guitar player, this economy should enable you to become a great guitar player and earn your livelihood as a guitar player. You want to become a mathematician, there should be a possibility for you to do that. You want to become a historian, there should be a possibility for you. When I shifted to history, behind to become a historian as a value of a profession, all the people around me seem to have a collective heart attack. They continue to have a heart attack even when I said, look, my salaries are pretty good actually. They are much better than their salaries anywhere else. They said, I mean, at every point, people seem to believe that you cannot do things in India. A productive economy is one in which people stop behaving like that. It's nothing to do with the amount of money that you have. It doesn't have to do anything with the amount of food that you have or the places, the amount of space that you have for living. In Europe, if you go, you people are living in IIT hostels, you discover that in Europe, a normal hotel is like that. They charge you 100 euros for living in the room of that variety. So, 10 by 10 ka bhi kamra nahi hai. Us kamre ke liye 100 euro charge karte.
So, the linen is better.
Huh?
The linen is better.
Linen is better.
Yes.
So, in a society which stops bothering about how will people live.
It is taken for granted that everyone would be able to live comfortably and live well. That is the society in which is we say it's a productive economy now. Textiles is a complicated story. I thought that I'll keep medicine, textile and metallurgy for one of the later lectures because it would require going into a lot of details. And the textile story, because it is so common in India, we've heard about ki kis tarah se angrejon ne weavers ke anguthe kaat diye the. All these are stories which we've read in school, or at least our parents have told us or grandparents have told us. We need to go into this story a little in greater detail to understand how the Indian textile industry actually challenged the European textile industry, not just the British textile industry, and came out tops as early as 1920. And this was despite the government creating every obstruction that a government can possibly create. Tax obstructions, technological obstructions, manpower obstructions, and yet the Indian textile industry flourished. So how did it flourish then, and why did it collapse all of a sudden in the 1970s, 80s? Those of you who come from Bombay, you would have seen how the collapse happened in a span of 5 years. Achha Bhala industry, the huge production units, and they simply shut down in a span of 5 years, all of them. That actually is a story about what happened with social justice gone wrong. Too much of a search for social justice can result in a total disaster also. The Indian textile industry is an example of that.
This trend in these two industries, or two or three industries, what would you predict as the industry best poised for the next revolution? So which would be the one or two industries which are likely to grow like these two did in the last?
See, these two are unique. Add the textile industry to it. Now the textile industry is completely automated, and at least yarn production wise, we are tops in the world. For having any other industry too, we now need a mindset change in society. The barriers that are to our thinking, those barriers need to be removed. The barriers to do with caste, barriers to do with religion, barriers to do with Brahmanavad. This Brahmanavad business is a serious problem. I mean, the Brahmanavad in India is rooted so deeply that in Indian society there's a problem if you sit on the daine wala kursi or bhai wala kursi. Abhi, you guys are fresh into the economy, so you haven't experienced these problems. who will enter the doorway first? Who will sit down first? Who will sit on the right side and who will sit on the left side? The problem starts from this. These problems, hierarchical issues, in a military setup, I can fully understand. Militaries and professional diplomats thrive on this kind of hierarchy. But when it starts happening in civil society, there's a problem coming. When everyone tries to make out as if they are very superior beings, without necessarily having the skills for being superior, then we say that the society is a problem. When people say that we will kill our daughters because our daughter has married someone, इससे हमारे परिवार की बेइज्जती कर दी. People say कि जो upper caste के लोग इनकी problem होगी. Sorry, it's not an upper caste problem anymore. The upper caste are not killing anyone anymore. It's the judges who are killing their daughters in hierarchy. It's the lower caste Rajputs in Gujarat who are killing their daughters. The lower caste Rajputs and Jats in Rajasthan who are killing their daughters. So why are they doing it? Because they say that killing your daughter in the name of honor brings honor to the family. Now, this is no way of bringing honor to anything. And any society which presumes that this is the right way of bringing in honor, that society needs to have an exam. And therefore, the importance of telling the society that you are doing the wrong thing and you should not be doing this thing, please change your behavior. In Punjab side, in Chandigarh, Haryana, we have seen of people Beti Chude Parivar Se, the sweeper caste. She's fallen in love with a Brahmin boy. She marries the Brahmin boy, and the sweeper caste family goes and kills the daughter and the son-in-law, saying that the girl has brought dishonor to the family. Now, this completely goes against whatever we presumed about caste hierarchy. These are the mind barriers which exist with us. They have to do with religion, they have to do with caste, they have to do with this notion of purity and pollution. And there is a big notion which Mahatma Gandhi used to struggle with. How to make people realize that working with your hands is a good thing? Mahatma Gandhi's answer to this was, and this answer came to him in 1899, when he joined the military. Mahatma Gandhi participated in the Zulu War. And Mahatma Gandhi said that the problem with Indians is that Indians don't respect a person who's working with his hands. You will have to start respecting a person who works with his hands. You will have to start respecting the person who's plying a rickshaw, and you will have to say that this rickshaw puller is as good as you or I, and it's possible for us to sit on the same table and eat food. Whenever I've gone to Pakistan, one of the big things that I've been told in Pakistan is this. We won't start our khana yet. We wait for the cook to join us. We will wait for the driver to join us. We will wait for the chapasi to join us. We will wait for the bearer to join us. And then there will be this huge plate in the middle. Food will be heaped on it. And everyone will eat from that. You're not given your own plate. Indians who visit Pakistan, they have a very, very difficult time. उसी प्लेट में से कैसे खाना खाए, मियाँ बीवी एक ही प्लेट में खा ले, बेटी बेटा एक ही प्लेट में खा ले, माँ बेटे एक ही प्लेट में खा ले, तब तो चलता है. इसके आगे तो थैंक यू वेरी मच बोलना पड़ेगा. इन पाकिस्तान में डोंट इवन थिंक अबाउट इट, गाइस, दे जस्ट डू इट. एंड व्हेन वन ऑफ आवर फ्रेंड्स हेजिटेटेड, दे सेड इन इंडिया यू पीपल हैव अ प्रॉब्लम नो ईटिंग टुगेदर. Of course, Indians have a problem. Indians will have to start having their problem. Indians will have to start thinking of other human beings as normal human beings.
Pakistan came out of India. And as per your table that you must put the slides, this caste problem is older than 900 years. So, we have been doing this for 900 years. So, there must be some reinforcement.
Pakistan didn't get out of it completely. They got out of this food business. But then this food business, the Punjabis also got out of it fast. in Punjab today, when you sit down in a pulpit and you just eat food made by anyone. Don't get too taken in by those video clips which some people have posted on the YouTube saying how caste exists in Punjab. Caste exists in Punjab, no doubt about that. But this is not the form that it takes. In Punjab, everyone eats food with everyone else. They have the separate taste. But you eat the food cooked by anyone, you eat food with anyone. There are no distinctions about that. It has to do with that mindset change. And it was not Islam which said that you should eat food together. It was the gurus of the Sikhs who said that you should eat food together. The gurus came up in the 16th century with this notion that food has to be collected. Food cannot be a breaking point. And you cannot have a mess which is a separate. The Indian armies, when they used to go out in the field, every Sipahi will have his own chula. Every Sipahi will have his own degchi. And in this chula and in this degchi, every Sipahi will make his own khichdi. The Sikhs were the first bunch of people who said that this business of everyone keeping their own degchi and own khichdi is out. There will be one deg, and in this deg, everyone will put whatever they have, vegetables dalo, chawal dalo, dal dalo, जो भी चीज़ उसमें डालना है डालो, एक पीपा भीता भी डालो, इसको आधा घंटा उबालो, और इसी में से कढ़ाई भर के अपनी प्लेट में लेके दो लेले पसंद लेके खा लो। That was the Sikhs, and the Sikh gurus insisted, not one after the other for 250 years, that you cannot make this distinction on food. Commensality का जो distinction कहते हैं सोशियोलॉजिस्ट कहते हैं, that distinction on food eating, that was the Sikhs doing. The Pakistanis seem to have adopted it, because remember, Pakistan is as caste-ridden today as India is. The Pakistanis adopted it because the kind of Islam that they practice is heavily influenced by Sikhism. Remember, almost 3/4 of Pakistan is actually Punjabi. And they had been living with the Punjabi. They did want partition, okay, it was the UP guys who wanted partition. You know, the Biharis who wanted partition, Punjabi who the Bekar mein gala kaat diya. They picked it up from Sikhism and they follow it till today. And of course, when it comes to interacting with us, Indians, then it also makes for a grand political statement, no? And you have these three Indians sitting with you and all of a sudden one of them balks at eating from the plate. As soon as you balk from eating, ek toh wo gaay ka maas tumhara kaam hai. फिर उससे आप बिचक जाते हो, उसके बाद आप उस पेट से खाने से बिचक जाते हो, तो उनके लिए तो ये अखबार में छापने वाली खबर हो जाती है ना, उनके लिए दिस बिकम्स अ न्यूज़ व्हिच रीइंफोर्सेस द आइडिया अबाउट हाउ पाकिस्तान इज अ ग्रेटर एंड अ बेटर कंट्री देन इंडिया इज. कास्ट डिस्टिंक्शन इन इंडिया हैज नथिंग टू डू विद रिलीजन, इट हैज नथिंग टू डू विद क्लास, इट हैज नथिंग टू डू विद रीजन. अक्रॉस द रीजंस दिस कास्ट डिस्टिंक्शन हैज बीन देयर. People said that the tribal communities don't have caste. Yes, tribal communities don't have caste till such time that the poor and not powerful. The moment they become rich and powerful, as in Chhattisgarh and Jharkhand, as in some parts of the Northeast, they promptly adopt all the latkas of caste. The latkas of caste, the parameters of caste hierarchy in which you can show that you are a greater person than I am simply because the manner in which you drink water, or the manner in which you eat your rice, or the manner in which you break your chapati, these small signs seem to be giving so much pressure to Indians that we just have to tell Indians to stop being pressured by such things. This is not something which you should keep happening. And the way out, to my mind at least, is what Gandhi used to say, start making all Indians work with their hands. Ensure that there is dignity of labor. This is a phrase which Gandhi used to use again and again. Dignity, bring dignity of labor. The moment dignity of labor comes in, chances are that people will start respecting those who work. Because in the caste hierarchy, essentially the person who's lower down is the person who's working with his hands. So whether you're working on a factory floor, whether you're working in an office, whether you're working at home, the person who works with their hands is lower down in social hierarchy. This will have to go. So, what are the strategies by which we can ensure that this goes? That is something that we shall be talking about later.
So, I think so we have been talking about nations and part of the community. So, my question is that what is the real meaning of nation? Rashtra kya hai?
Rashtra kya hai? डेफिनेशनली बोलूं, सब क्या कहें तो डेफिनेशनली बोल दे रहा जाएंगे. A nation is any people who identify themselves as distinct from everyone else and who create markers for their distinctiveness. This is the historically accurate ideal type definition of what a nation is. Expand kare isko, a nation is a word derived from birthplace, nation, where you are born, you have a special love, it is presumed. This love is the one which brings people who are born at the same place together. I was born in Jabalpur, Victoria Hospital, room number 203. Room number 203 mein paida hue baaki logon ko to main janta bhi nahi hu. Mera unse koi pyar nahi hai, mera unke sath koi nationalism ka sambandh nahi hai. So obviously that first bit of the definition is incorrect. You have got a special love for the place that you are born. The second bit is, you should have someone whom you can collectively oppress, which is a very good way of defining a nation. All of us can get together and say that now we are going to oppress someone else. That's what the British did. Karl Marx had sat down and Karl Marx had said that there's a basic distinction between people who have capital and people who work. Workers and the proletariat and the bourgeoisie, they are at loggerheads. The bourgeoisie is constantly exploiting the workers. The workers are going to rebel and bring about the change that Karl Marx wanted. Okay, so he was waiting for a revolution to happen, and he said what happened was the government said all workers can join the army. There is no distinction. We will even create structures by which the workers can become promoted and become officers and generals. So the workers promptly joined the army. In due course of time, many of them became officers and generals also. And they all fought with other workers of other nations. Marx's dream was finished 10 years the moment he made this statement. So the nation is not about being in a particular class position either. Nation then just may be, and this is something which our fellow Benedict Anderson stated. He was studying Indonesia, and the same problem that India faces, Indonesia was facing. And Benedict Anderson's answer was, nation is something in the mind. Once you have the idea of living together, it really doesn't matter how different you are from each other, you'll be able to live together. And that's why the examples that I gave about Khalistan and Nagaland and Assam and Kashmir, that despite being so intensely hostile to each other, we still continue to live together, and hence we should take it as a sign of being part of the same nation. It's a state of mind, nation.
Repeat the question.
The question is, before the East India Company, we were divided into small state units, and therefore we were not a nation. My interjection to that is, basically what I am saying is, if after paring through all the definitions of a nation, all the explanations of a nation, all the understandings of a nation provided by political scientists, lawyers and sociologists, after I have rejected all of them and I stick to the historian's definition of a nation, saying that nation is a state of mind, then those guys, the state of mind was the same. They all worked together, they all worked in harmony, there was no distinction between them. We can say that they were independent political units, but as a people they were the same. That is something which people make a statement about, that India was culturally united. Because it really did not matter. This is something which we will pick up a little in greater detail when we meet the next time. It really did not matter whether you landed at the Karachi-Balochistan seacoast, or whether you landed at Kochi, or whether you landed at Vishakhapatnam. If you were a foreigner, you landed at these places and you said that I have come to India, I have come to Hindustan. If you were in India, when you went from the Ahom kingdom in the northeast, Assam area, you went to Kutch, you still said that you were in Bharatvarsha. These are official reports written down. So we know that people are identifying themselves as one. This Shankaracharya fellow comes up in South India and he says that you should be moving around and talking to each other. So he sets up rules which say that Char Dham ki yatra karni padegi. So you are born in Tamil Nadu, and then one day you up your bags, take all your kinsmen with you, take a few horses and oxen, and you start moving northward. First you go to Kutch, Gujarat, then you move towards Punjab, then you climb up the mountains, go to Kashmir, you come down by the mountains to Kangra, cross over to Uttarakhand, you visit all those other places, you go further east, you visit the Dwar areas, then you start coming down the coast via Puri, and you say, Pura Bharatvarsh dekh liya. You are a Bharatvarshi. Isme ye jo identity thi, this identity cannot have been a political identity. Is this, we never had a problem with legal identity either. But why did we not have a political problem? Why did we not have a legal problem? And why did we not have a cultural problem? Because after all, the guy from Tamil Nadu who was moving to Kutch, I don't think that he knew the language. People pick, when you're traveling a lot, you pick up languages. But beyond picking up languages, you cannot be an accomplished communicator in a new language. So, itna to logo ko pakka pata chalega ki ye bhasha kaise bolte hain. Kachhi bhasha jo hai, wo hamari bhasha se, kahi bhasha se bilkul fark hai. Itna to logo ko pata rahega. And yet he thinks that he's Bharatvarshi. So, why is this unity coming up? This is something that we should be going into greater detail using maps. Because for that, you need maps. You need to imagine the thing in front of you so that you can understand why. Because otherwise what happens is we got stuck with this legalistic definition of a nation. Legalistic definition of a nation is India is from the Saltoro Ridge to Kanyakumari. So what happens with Aksai Chin? What happens with the area beyond Saltoro Ridge? What is Gilgit India? The law says yes, Gilgit is India. Is the Karakoram Highway India? The law says yes, the Karakoram Highway is India. And yet we know that आपका रूल बन गया 1 million rupees का फाइन है यदि मैं ये कहूँ कि कारापुरम हाईवे इंडिया नहीं है तो वो कैंडी को कम से कम रिकॉर्डिंग दे दूँगा How a region is decided? Oh, this is something to do with geography. Regions are decided by geography. Kings are helpless. Politicians, economists, markets, they are helpless in front of geography. Geography determines what a region is.
I mean that how particular person can decide that this particular region is my India? Like.
Okay. That how can a person decide that this particular area, I mean let's take the example of the Ahom Kingdom and the Kutch and the Baluchistan area and say that this is India, so how does one say that this is all India? How can I as a traveler presume that this is all India? The answer to that lies in the geography of India. We shall go into the details too. Hang on that question. The next time that we meet, not the next time, the time after that when we meet, we shall be talking about it in greater detail because that is something that we need to be clear about. That is the crux of what an Indian is. Yeah.
So the three examples that you gave us of the
last question.
What was it that my question is two parts. What was it that made them come back to India? You can elaborate a little on that. And secondly, what was it that made them hesitate from leaving?
The question is, what was it which made all those rebels who were rebelling against India hesitate in leaving India? And the second thing is, what was it which made them come back to India? Both these questions require long answers, long explanations. The short answer to that is, which I can just share with you at the moment, India is a soft state. India is not a hard state like Abraham Lincoln's America. Abraham Lincoln said that these South Carolina guys who are attacking my garrison, I'm going to send my army and crush them. In India, that has never ever happened. Once you get into service, you will discover, and you are trick in service. Once you are in service, please go ahead and do any nonsense to your boss that you feel like you are. Your boss, and if you are in Sarkari Nauki Bhatto, you are absolutely free to do every nonsense that you want to your boss. No one is ever going to harm. If you are in a private service, you will discover that your boss will feel such serious kinds of conscience in harming you. Your teachers, when they are troubling you, are not giving you marks adequately. Once in a while, they succeed, but most of the time, they are having these pangs of conscience. Yaar, tangi karna chahiye bachche ko, tangi karna chahiye isko, uske pet pe laathi maarna chahiye, chalo usne meri beizzati bahut zyada kar di, usko 25 gaal ja denge, par usko, people say Indians don't have a killer instinct. I don't think there's anyone who lacks a killer instinct. But I do believe that in India, culturally speaking, we are a soft state. And the soft state is not about the state being useless and not hostile enough and not being powerful enough to crush people. But somehow, culturally, we do not like to take those strong positions which will harm people, which will crush people, which will destroy people. And we've not done that ever. And hence, there's a problem which comes up with things like communalism. When we say, Sikh dange hue the, Delhi mein. Then immediately someone else says, but dekho kitne saare Hindu ne Sikho ko bachaya bhi to tha. When we say, Musalmanon ke dange hue the, we immediately get up and say, no, I know so many cases in which bachaya bhi to tha. We say, caste collective oppression was there. Then someone gets up and says, nahi, dekho itni madad bhi to ki thi. So, ye jo chota sa confusion aata hai, other societies this confusion doesn't exist. And we need to, just like I was telling you a little bit of the story of America today, I'll be sharing with you a little bit of the story of Africa and Europe, just to give you a comparison about what happens in India and how people deal with such issues in India. Keep it pending for some time. Yeah?
Oh. It could go on and on. And as you can see, we are very provocative and very knowledgeable speakers here. I find it very interesting. I've never experienced history reading like almost a racy novel whenever he comes and talks about it. And he gives us a very unique and very broad and deep perspective into what has happened in the past. And you'll agree, right, that this is a very different kind of history lecture. Those who agree, please put their hands up. Those who
Thank you so much.
So it gives us great delight to have him here with us. He was here with us last year, we discovered him, and we thought it would be great to have him here again. And keep these things interactive. Put him on the mat, ask him difficult questions. We want to see how he performs then, right? And ask questions which mean things to you and us and everybody here. And my reason for having invited him here is that this Make in India, I'm trying to get a feel for it. Right? What is the genius of the Indian people? What are the industries that we should be looking at? What are the latent energies which might be there in this country, which we could harness? Right? Perhaps this is an attempt to understand ourselves better, understand the potentials which are around us in the country better, in a very different kind of way. Right? So see, in that spirit, and be happy to brainstorm, be happy to ask questions, because I'm sure he's also getting stimulated also in the process. And we are hoping to make each of these talks a chapter in a book, which perhaps the Yantra can also be a part of. So any interaction that you bring out will only add to this, right, and make it more rich. So thank you again very much, sir.
Thank you, sir.